On today's episode, we're out in the garage and we're going to be turning a bottle opener. Why does that sound so familiar?
Welcome back to Matt's Basement Workshop. Sponsored by
MicroJig, maker of the Gripper. Work safer, work smarter.
And by Centipede Tool, manufacturer of the Centipede Portable Work System, the ultimate in portable work support. For more information, visit centipedetool.com.
Hey everybody, welcome back to Matt's Basement Workshop. So on today's episode, like I mentioned in the beginning, we're making another bottle opener. Now don't worry, unlike last summer where we had like the summer of bottle openers, we're just making this one single one. And I really like this because again, it's an opportunity for me to get to the lathe and to just try things out and become familiar with my tools and just have fun. And more importantly, as you can see right here with the three that I've made probably in just the past couple of hours at the most, I have three pretty much completed projects. I just simply need to attach the heads to them. And that's one of the beauties of working at the lathe. It really is something that you can just knock out a whole bunch of stuff in the afternoon and have some great gifts to give to people or to keep one for yourself. In fact, I think I might be keeping this one in particular. Anyways though, when it comes to using the hardware, it's really super simple. The manufacturer recommendation is to drill a 3/8 inch hole at the top, and we'll see this in the footage here. You'll just drop the hardware in place, and actually you'll apply some epoxy in here first, then drop it in, and once it sets up, it's all set to go, and you have a really fancy bottle opener. So let's go ahead, jump into the footage, and take a look at how we did this. And in fact, actually the footage we'll be seeing is for this teak version right here, which absolutely is, this one's gorgeous too. Maybe I'll keep this one, I'm not sure. Well, maybe by the end of the video, I'll figure out which one of these, if I don't keep this one, I'm gonna keep. So let's get right into it.
So this is probably way too obvious, but the first step is taking this square blank and making it round. And that's a job easily accomplished with my roughing gouge. And after a couple of passes, well, I can already hear that we're starting to get close. So now it's just a couple more and we'll be ready to move on to the next step. That next step involves using a spindle gouge to round over this first end. So one thing I should have done for more control over the gouge would have been to have moved the tool rest closer and then just raise it slightly. So that's exactly what I'm doing here. I stop the lathe and I take care of it now before I have any kind of catch later on. Now with the tool rest closer, I can continue to sneak up on that rounded end. But before I do any more shaping, I want to take the time to drill the hole the bottle opener is actually going to fit into. So to hold the blank in place for the drill bit, I pop out the drive center and I install my chuck and then tighten the jaws down on the blank. And then over on the tailstock, I'm going to swap out the live center and I'll replace it with the Jacobs chuck that's outfitted with a 3/8 inch brad point drill bit. Then once everything's in place, it's time to drill the hole. And then we'll check the depth to make sure it fits just right. And now that that's all taken care of, it's time to get back to shaping the blank. So my original intent was to actually replicate one of the previous bottle openers that I turned. And to help me do that, I mark on the blank the approximate locations of where I'll be, one, removing material, and two, also kind of having an idea of where I'm going to start doing some of the shaping maneuvers that we'll see in just a little bit. So once I get the lines drawn, I'm going to go ahead and get myself all set here to grab my spindle gouge. And now to start removing some of that waste material that I don't want in there. You know, this is something that I could have easily done with my rough and gouge, is cogging away some of this material. But again, I'm going to use the spindle gouge just in case I didn't decide to make some sort of design alteration, which actually happens quite frequently when I'm working on some sort of turning project. And just a little spoiler alert, it actually happens in this, but we'll see a little bit more about that in just a few minutes here. But either way, you can hog away material with both gouges rather quickly. And that's exactly what I'm going to do here with the spindle gouges, kind of keep working away at removing this material. Now, the one thing I do have to remind myself over and over when I'm using the spindle gouge is to only work downhill, kind of going from a high spot to a low spot. It's amazing how fast a spindle gouge will get away from you when you go in the wrong direction. And for those of you who have pointed this out to me and kind of helped me bettering myself when it comes to turning, that is probably one of the key things that I will always remember. But unfortunately, I often remember it when it's too late, and then now we move on to a different design alteration. But so far, so good with this project. Now that the shape is starting to come along, I need to check the diameter on the end here. There's a little cap at the base of the head of the hardware, and I want to sneak up on it for a seamless finished look. Well, apparently I have a little ways to go, but not too far. So it's back to the spindle gouge, and we're going to do some more refining. Once I've finally reached the final diameter for the head, I'm turning my attention back to the body. And this time I'm using an Easy Wood Tools Easy Finisher. This works great at giving me this cove effect below the head. And then eventually above the tail also. But right after that, well, as it tends to happen once in a while, it's time for design modification, and I grab the spindle gouge to start hogging away some more material, and then round over the hard edges even further. Now at this point, I was thinking I was almost at the final shape, so I grab my Easy Detailer tool and use it very much like a parting tool to add some cool lines to the head. Now, unfortunately, apparently I'm not very good at gauging the distance between each one of them, and I ended up actually getting a little too close with this third one that I'm about to make here. So once I realized what happened, I figured I'd just go back in and maybe add a couple here and there to try and somehow balance things out. While I'd like to think that it was a good idea, as you can see, I'm not sure that actually worked out all that great, but we'll still work with this. So then I decided, once I have a few at the top, it's time to maybe add one at the bottom. Or so I thought, until I once again make a design modification on the fly, and I decide to grab my spindle gouge to refine it once more. Now the last design modification I decide to make is here at the base. As I'm looking at it, it's just too fat for my taste, so using the Easy Detailer again, working very much like a parting tool, I start to define the new end of the base, and then once I have that taken care of, I go ahead and start refining with, what else? My spindle gouge. Something new that I wanted to try out on this project was burning the wood in these grooves. Now, I've seen this elsewhere, and I thought it was really cool, and I wanted to give it a try, so here I'm using just some picture-hanging wire that I found laying around and a couple of blocks of wood for handles. And while it took probably just a little bit longer because I think the wire was a little too thick for the grooves, I got exactly the result I wanted. You can see the smoke coming off of here. And once I had that first one done, it was easy to move on to the other ones and give me the same exact look, and it turned out absolutely beautiful. Not bad for a first effort. And the final step, of course, is to sand the whole project down. So we're going to start going through our various grits. And here, we begin with the 150. We'll then move on to the 240. And we'll finish with 600. And for the finish, we're just going to use Shella Wax, which is a really great friction finish. I have a hard time saying that. Friction finish. You just simply wipe it onto the piece. You get it nice and wet. And then once the finish is completely applied, you turn on the lathe and you start applying friction just using something as simple as the paper towel that you applied it with. And in no time at all, you have a nice solid finish that's going to easily withstand all sorts of wear and tear as the years go on. And the final step is to cut the bottle opener free from the waste at the drive center end. Some light sanding and eventually a little finish on the end. And the turning portion of this project is completed. The only thing left to do is to epoxy the hardware into place.
All right, folks, so at this point, I still have not decided which one of these three I'm gonna keep for myself. I really, like I said, I love all three of them. This teak one was a lot of fun to do, and as we saw in the video, there was actually some last second design modifications that were going on there. This was the original one that I ended up making, and I love the shape of this one, but again, whenever I'm working at the lathe, I tend to kind of, once I get going and I know what I want it to look like, it always seems like somewhere in the middle, I suddenly go, you know what? I just want to experiment with something. And that's exactly what I was doing, especially here on the head. You might have noticed, if you really pay close attention to it, these rings right here, they're not quite spaced uniformly, and that was completely by accident. In fact, when I was going to make what would have been the second or third one, I kind of dropped that detailer, the Easy Wood Tools detailer, kind of in the wrong spot. So at that point, it's like, all right, well, we're here, let's make another design modification. So we kept kind of playing around with it, but I'm still very happy with this. I think it looks absolutely gorgeous, and I had a lot of fun. One thing I did try that was new, and I'm gonna talk about more about this in the patrons bonus footage, is doing the burning here, and that's really super simple. As you saw, it was just a wire, but we'll get the more details about that in that bonus footage. But anyways, though, it is a lot of fun and, like I said, a super quick and easy project to do. If you have comments, questions, suggestions, I love hearing from all of you. You can email me at mattsbasementworkshop@gmail.com. You can stop by the website at mattsbasementworkshop.com and leave a comment in the show notes for today's episode. And if you're watching this over at YouTube, I love hearing from all of you. You can leave a comment over there. So until the next time, I'll be talking to you soon. Hopefully I'll have decided which one of these three I'm going to keep. Like I said, I don't know. Hopefully I'll know by then. So straight grains and sharp blades. Take care, everybody. It's eeny, meeny.
Thanks for watching. For more information on topics discussed in this episode, visit mattsbasementworkshop.com. Also, please consider becoming a patron of Matt's Basement Workshop. Get early access to new shows, bonus content from each episode, and so much more. Visit patreon.com/mattsbasementworkshop to sign up and start receiving your benefits today.